Message. We're going to do a 4 weeks kind of series, and we're trying to determine what's going to be the name of the series. It's going to be about heaven, and you can name the series if you want to, but we're going to do 4 messages on heaven, talk about Jesus coming back. Today's title of today's sermon is Ain't Nobody Got Time for That. You like that? Ain't nobody got time for that. You guys maybe remember a video, there's a YouTube clip a while ago, and there's a lady that her house caught on fire, her apartment complex got on fire, and she smelled it. She thought somebody was barbecuing, and she started running out the house, and the smoke caused her to have bronchitis. And she goes, I got bronchitis, and ain't nobody got time for that. Well, today we're going to talk about things we ain't got time for. Because Jesus is coming back.
Amen.
Yeah. I say that again. There's things in our lives that we don't got time for because Jesus is coming back.
Amen.
All right. And so this morning's message, we're going to be looking in the book of Matthew, chapter 24. We're going to look at Jesus' words about his return. And my prayer for us this morning is that we get the same kind of attitude as that lady had. I ain't got time for that. I ain't got time for playing around. I ain't got time for it because Jesus is coming back. This was such a reality for me growing up in a Christian home. I don't know how many here grew up in a Christian home, but I remember days where I thought Jesus had returned because I had such a fear, maybe a knowledge that Jesus was returning, that if mom and dad, you know, this, I'm not that old, but it was before cell phones, they had cell phones. So if mom and dad, like, didn't return back from a meeting that we knew, okay, they're supposed to get back at 8 o'clock, and now it's like 8:45. You know, they all of a sudden creeped into my life this fear that I had missed out, that Jesus had come back, and he had taken mom and dad, and I was not righteous. I was found not righteous, and I was stuck at home. Anybody else have those kind of memories? There's a few people that grew up in the church. Yeah, you know, right? And so I remember that, like, reality, you know, worried. Where is mom and dad? Mom and dad didn't come back. You know, I look around the house, and maybe my siblings weren't around. I'm like, I'm the only one. And there's like, that was probably spurred on a little bit by a book series. Anybody know the Left Behind book series?
Yes.
Yeah, see, there's a few people in here that been around the church for a while. All right. So the Left Behind series was a book series all about you left behind. Jesus coming back. Jesus is coming back.
Yep.
And I don't know how much of a reality that is for you, but Jesus is coming back.
Yeah.
It's the truth of his word. And so this morning we're going to look at that and look at what that means for us, that I hope that we're ready. And I hope it creates in us an attitude just like that lady said, I ain't got time for that. I mean, there's things in my life I know that I'm still entertaining that I ain't got time for because Jesus is coming back. It's a serious thing. He's coming back, and he's coming back for a church that is ready for him. Right? And so let's look here. We're going to look in Acts chapter 1 first. In Acts chapter 1, Jesus gets to talk to his disciples one last time. And I love this promise in Acts chapter 1 that he speaks to his disciples, and he says that there is power that's going to come for those who wait on the Lord. Yes. Well, maybe the next series. No, I already know the next series, but I mean, we'll get to talk about that power. But in Acts chapter 1, verse 6, it says this. So they had come together. They asked him, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom of Israel? I love them disciples. It reminds me of myself so much.
Yeah.
If you don't know, the disciples here still haven't figured everything out. That the kingdom of God is not something that was going to happen then and now, but it was something that was begin then, but was going to come in the future. And they still wanted Jesus to be that Messiah that would come and just overthrow. I love that because it shows me sometimes still I don't got everything in order. I don't have all my beliefs in order. But man, I just want what Jesus has for me. So Jesus responds to them. He says this, it is not for you to know the times or the seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. And he will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. And when he had said these things, as they were looking on, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. And while they were gazing into heaven as he went, behold, two men stood by them in white robes and said, Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking into heaven? This Jesus who was taken up from heaven will in the same way as you saw him go into heaven, return. Man, I like this. The same way that Jesus went into heaven, he's going to return. And so we're going to look this morning at Matthew. I said we're going to look mainly at Matthew 24. This is going to be a passage. If you have time this week, I want to encourage you to read through Matthew 24 and 25. I love it in my Bible that even the new one here that I got from Kurt, all of Jesus' words are red. So I love this passage of scripture where I know this is what Jesus is saying. So it's like, this is good stuff. And we're not going to be able to get through all of it this morning. There's multiple stories that Jesus tells, multiple emphasis that Jesus has on his return, on the preparation for his return. But we're going to go through here this morning, and I'm praying that we receive from God what he has to say to us this morning. Because just like the angels told the men that saw him leave, he's returning. He's returning for us. So let's pray this morning that our ears would be open and our hearts would be open to receive what God would speak to us. God, we are grateful again to be here in your presence, to be here with fellow brothers and sisters in Christ, to worship you, to honor you, and follow the Lord to receive from you. So God, I pray, Lord, just as Rachel prayed, God, I pray that as I speak, Father, Lord, it wouldn't just be my words, but Father, it would be your words that are spoken to us. Father, Lord, help us to learn new things, help us to gain wisdom, and Father, I pray that you would help us to heed to your words this morning. Father, let them transform us. Let them change our actions in response to who you are and who you're being revealed as. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Let's go in Matthew chapter 24. I love the scriptures and the title headings that they have. It starts off with this. And the question I have all the time, when is Jesus going to come back? I'm thinking about this. When is Jesus going to come back? I kind of want him to come back now. I don't know about you guys. I'm like, Jesus, if you just chose today, right now, I'll be satisfied.
Amen.
You know why that is? I think if we understand what heaven's going to be like, if we understand what union with God will be like, it's a good thing. I didn't even write these scriptures down. Let's turn to Revelations chapter 21. I just want to paint a picture for you guys of what it's going to be like when Jesus returns and he makes everything right. And there's going to be, in this series, there's going to be a lot of detail to go through. There's a lot of things that are said about his return, what that means for us, the new heavens and the new earth and all sorts of good things. When is it coming? Is it coming in the middle, in the end? Some of you guys know those terms. And you know what? I'll just be honest with you. Here, as your pastor, you know what I care about? I care about this. Jesus said he's coming back, and we need to prepare for that.
Yeah.
But in this series, we'll get through some of those details a little bit and answer a few of those questions that we may have about the details of what it means. But let's look here. We're going to go to Revelation just a second before we turn over to Matthew. Because I was reading this, and I was just like, man, that sounds really good. I kind of want that. All right, Matthew chapter 21, 22. And chapter 21, it starts off this way. It says, there's going to be a new heaven and a new earth, the first heaven and the first earth that passed away, and the sea is no more. And they saw a holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. I like that. The dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away. And he who is seated on the throne said, Behold, I am making all things new. Write this down, for the words are trustworthy and true. And he said to me, It is done. I am Alpha and Omega, which means I am the beginning and the end. The thirsty I will give from the to the thirsty I will give from the spring of the water of life without payment. The one who conquers will have this heritage, and I will be his God, and he will be my son. But as for the cowardly, the faithless, the detestable, for the murderers, for the sexual immoral, for the sorcerers, for the adulterers, for the liars, their portion will be in the lake that burns with fire and sulfur, which is the second death. Man, when I'm thinking about heaven, all things new, no more pain. Linda, you're going to be excited about that. No more pain. Oh, no more suffering.
Yes.
No more crying. No more fear. No more death. Verse 20, chapter 22, we're going to look at that in just a second. Let me... Verse 20, 22, verse 20 says, He testifies these things. Surely I am coming soon. Surely I am coming soon. To bring this reunion with the Father. So let's look back. I'm sorry, I went all the way over there to come back to chapter 24 of Matthew. But the Jesus is returning, and what he's going to return for is to bring us into this perfect union with the Father, where He is the Lord of them. His dwelling place is with us permanently. And in that, in chapter 22, it also says that they wipes away the curse. There will be no more curse. I'm like, yes, God, I want that. Because I recognize in life that everything that is not of God, that is not good, that is not pleasing, it is evidence of the curse. It is evidence of sin. And so when God comes to make his dwelling place among us, it's a holy place, it's a blameless place, it's a blemish-free place, it's a place that no more curse exists.
Amen.
And I'm like, yes, Lord, I want that. Yes, Lord, bring it on. So let's look here, Matthew 24. What are the signs that Jesus is coming back? In verse 24, verse 7, it says this. Verse 6. See to it that you are not. Sorry, I'm looking. Verse 6. And you will hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you are not alarmed, for this must take place. But the end is not yet. For nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there will be famines and earthquakes in various places. All these are but the beginning of birth pains. And so, I'm like reading this about Jesus, and Jesus said, I'm going to come back, but before I come back, things are going to get bad. And you know, every generation, every church generation has looked around and said, things are bad. I mean, if I'm thinking about the first century church, when the Romans just hated their very lives, hated their very being. I mean, they thought the Lord was coming back. And we talk about, man, in the last 40, 50 years in America, I mean, we look around and we're like, man, things are getting bad. Things are looking bad. Every new generation, I want to say, we got some people, every new president come in, and it is like, oh, it's getting worse. It's getting worse. It's getting, you know what? It is. Sin is there, but he says this, all these are but the beginning of birth pains. So we look around and he says that we're going to be able to know because we're going to be able to recognize his thing. So in my heart, this is how I read the scripture. I'm like, okay, I can look around, everything's bad. Everything was bad for the first century Christians. Everything's bad all the time. Every generation of Christians in America said, hey, it's getting worse. It's getting worse. You know what it means? Be prepared. Be ready. Jesus can come back at any time. You look around and things are happening in the world that, hey, that doesn't look like Jesus. That doesn't look like Scripture. Yeah, that doesn't look like love. It doesn't look like peace. It doesn't look like it. There's things around us. There's things that we experience in life. It looks like hatred. It looks like anger. It looks like war. It looks like famine. There's things that are happening. It's all around us. And Jesus said, this thing is going to happen. There's going to be a sign that I'm coming back. Look to me. That's what the invitation is. In verse 12, it says this, that lawlessness, and because lawlessness will increase, the love of many will grow cold. But the one who endures will be saved in the end. So lawlessness may increase all around us, and you know what I'm saying? It's sometimes even in the church, even in the last couple of years, I've seen over and over again more and more failures by pastors and minister friends that I know, right? It's just, there's lawlessness, there's people just casting aside, their love for God is growing cold, their love in general for others is growing cold, but endure. That's what Jesus' message is for us. And all these things are happening around us, all this hatred, the law, the enemy is taking advantage of things, the enemy seems like he's reigning, but hold on, Jesus is coming, Jesus is returning, Jesus is going to make all things right, he is our hope. Endure, for those who endure, they will be saved. Maybe an error in my theology as a little elementary school boy, thinking about, oh, what if Jesus returned? My parents are gone. Oh no, I'm left. Let's look at here that when Jesus returns, it's not going to be in secret. You guys know that? Let's look, Matthew 24. And there's a lot of scripture I can just read and it can preach for itself. But in verse 24, verse 15 through 28, Jesus talks specifically about, hey, there's going to be people that are going to come and they're going to say that I am the Lord. I am the Lord. Follow me. I am the Lord. And man, I can look at the history and say, yes, there's people that come and say, I am the Lord. They've led many astray. They've led many to have false beliefs. In verse 23, it says, if anyone says to you, look, here is Christ, or there he is, don't believe it. We have the revelation of who Jesus is. It's found right here in the Word of God. This is who Jesus is. Hold on to it. And let's continue this. Verse 24 says this, for false Christs and false prophets will arise and perform great signs and wonders so as to lead astray, if possible, even the elect, even those who follow after Jesus, even those who have made a decision after Jesus. Verse 25, it says this, see, I have told you before. So if they say to you, look, he is in the wilderness, don't go out.
That's right.
If they say, look, he is in inner rooms, do not believe it.
That's right.
For this is verse 27, this is the revelation, this is the truth. For as the lightning comes in the east and shines as far as the west, so will be the coming of the Son of Man. Wherever the corpse is, there is vultures that will gather. So wherever there are dead things, there are people that will gather. I mean, this is why we need, we just went through a series that says we need one another. Why? Because we need to be able to have some discernment. And sometimes, if I'm honest, I get led astray in this area or in that area. I need somebody to come alongside me to encourage me and to correct me. I need the Holy Spirit to I need to be full of the Holy Spirit and a church body that is full of the Holy Spirit so that we're not attracted to dead things. But Jesus says here, the statement he makes is, that he's going to come and lightning comes and shines across the sky, so will the coming of the Son of Man be. I grew up in North Carolina. I love lightning storms. I don't know if you guys have grown up in an area. Here in Wisconsin, we don't really get lightning storms. But man, down when I was on the coastline of North Carolina, where the humidity and the cool air, they would hit. Man, it would get lightning storm. We would be on the beach. The family sometimes would go do dinner on the beach, and all of a sudden in the evening time would roll in, and those storm clouds, I mean, and you can't not see these lightning strikes. I mean, they crack across the sky. It's beautiful. And when I read this passage of Jesus returning, I mean, that's what I'm thinking about. He said, when he returns, you're going to know it.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know, have you ever been, around here every once in a while the thunder gets loud enough that it wakes me up at night. But I mean, like, you can't ignore a thunderstorm, a lightning storm like that. And Jesus said, coming from the east, we see some prophecies here, he's coming from the east, he's going to return from the east, that man, the east of us, and it's going to be a loud sound. So here in verse 31, it goes on and it says, Then will I appear in heaven and the sun as a sign of the Son of Man. And then all the tribes on earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And he will send out his angels with a loud trumpet call, and they will gather his elect from the four winds, from the one end of heaven to another. Yeah. And this is where the Left Behind series is really fun, right? When they talk about Jesus returning, then all of a sudden people that were pilots were like missing all of a sudden, and you know, people in their cars, and there's like car crashes in the story. If you haven't read the books, I wouldn't say that they're great on theology, but they're really fun to read and enjoy the story and the fiction that they put together. It's really, yeah, I like those stories. But this is the scripture here that they're going off of, is that Jesus said, hey, when I return, I'm just going to be a great power in the sky, and there's going to be a trumpet sound that's going to blast, because the angels are ready to make all this thing happen. And then they're going to gather up, it says the elect is going to gather up those who have made Jesus Lord. Exciting. Right? This is what we're looking forward to. This is what, man, if we say we have a hope, I have a hope that whether it be when I die, I'm going to be present with the Lord, or Jesus returns. Man, Jesus, come. That's the Revelation chapter 22. Says that the bride and the spirit, we have a song, and that song is, come, Lord Jesus.
Amen.
Man, when I look at, you know, there's one side of me, right, that I'm like, when I look at destruction and I think about how sin is rampant in the world, one thing I want to go full charge and just help some people know Jesus. Like, let's get your life right. Like, there's one. And the other side of me say, Lord, come.
Yeah.
Because I know when he comes, man, heaven and earth will become one. God's dwelling place will come. And man, the curse will be no more. So, I mean, if anything, in prayer last night, we could have just said, Lord, Jesus, come. Like, we need you. This world needs you. Jesus. He's coming, and it's not going to be in secret.
That's right.
He's coming, and it's going to be evident. It's going to be a trumpet sound. There's going to be a lightning strike. It's going to be Jesus in all of his glory. So in Jesus' words, as he's speaking here, Matthew 24, he's talking about the signs. He's talking about what it's going to be like when he returns. And he goes into teaching mode. And right now, this is what, and we need to hear something from the Word of God this morning for us. And I know that in this series, Sunday morning will not be exhaustive on every point that Jesus makes about his return. It's not going to be exhaustive about every truth of heaven. It's not going to be exhaustive about the tribulation or any of those kind of excellent eschatological words. However, it's going to be focused on the truth of God's word and how to apply it. What does that mean for us today?
Amen.
God loves studying the Word of God, and I encourage you guys to study the Word of God. Study it out. Know it. Understand this theology. But there is some practical teaching that Jesus speaks about the end time that we need to hear. And specifically this morning, I just repeat it over and over again. Jesus says, we ain't got time to mess around. So let's read here, verse 36. It says this, but concerning that day and the hour, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but the Father only. I would just stop there. Nobody knows the time or the hour except for the Father. Nobody. Sometimes that's hard because they have some really good speakers that we like to listen to, some famous pastors, some people that wrote books about when it's going to happen, the day, the hour, the time, the sign. Nobody knows except for the Father. I got to know the Father. Jesus says he doesn't even know the time. So those people that prophesy, this is going to be the time, be ready, this is going to be the moment. I'm sorry, but I can say this in confidence. They're liars. Don't listen to them. They are like the false prophets, the false teachers that he just warned us about earlier in chapter 24. We don't know. So let's see what Jesus says about that. Because we don't know, this is what Jesus speaks to us this morning. Verse 37. For as were the days of Noah, so it will be the coming of the Son of Man. For as in those days, before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, until the day when Noah entered the ark. And they were unaware until the flood came and swept them all away, so will be the coming of the Son of Man. So it will be about our daily lives. We'll be living the way that we're living. We're going to be about the things that we're about. We're going to be, I hope I'm not still working at Curry in the Box, but maybe I'm still working at Curry in the Box, you know? Serving, typing some menu in, and all of a sudden, boom, there goes Andrew, right? It's going to be just like the days of Noah. They didn't know the judgment was coming. Noah prepared himself, though, for years, prepared for that flood coming. When the rain began to fall, the flood began to slip away, people were caught in the middle of exactly what they were doing. This is going to be what it's like when Jesus returns. We'll be about our business.
That's right.
I hope we're about God's business. Let's look at this. Verse 40. Then two men will be in the field. One will be taken and one will be left. Two women will be grinding at the meal. One will be taken, one will be left. Therefore, stay awake, for you do not know on what day your Lord is coming. But know this, that if the master of the house had known in what part of the night the thief was coming, he would have stayed awake and would not have let his house be broken into. Therefore, you also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour that you do not expect. You guys get that point there? When something said repeatedly over and over again, that's the point that we're going to receive. We do not know the hour that we're going to expect the Lord's return. So what is this focus to? His word to us. Be ready. Stay awake. In verse 43, it says this, if he would have known, he would have stayed awake and would not have let his house be broken into. Hey, last week, Rachel and I had both of our cars broken into in our parking lot. If I would have known that it was going to happen, I would have been awake. I would have been out there. I would have locked my doors. You don't prepare for those kind of things. Jesus is returning. He's returning in a moment. If I would have known, I would have been prepared. I would have been awake. I would have been alert. But guess what? This morning, if you didn't know already, Jesus is returning. It's time to get awake. Yep. It's time to stay alert. I don't have time. We don't have time to be messing around. Mm-hmm. What do you mean, Andrew? You can come back next week? I don't know. I just said to you, I don't know. But he's coming. But he's coming. And if you and I are praying for his coming, it's going to be soon. What does soon mean? I don't know. I haven't figured that one out. If there's a theologian in the room that knows what soon means, he'll tell me what it means. But it means he's coming, and I need to be ready. And you need to be ready. In Ephesians, why do we need to be ready? Oh, the Lord is returning. In Ephesians 5:27, it says that he's coming for a radiant church that was without stain or wrinkle or any blemish, but holy and blameless.
Amen.
Come on. We ain't got time to fool around. We ain't got time for pet sins. We ain't got time for addictions. We ain't got time for sleeping around. We ain't got time for cutting corners. We ain't got time for not listening to the word. We don't got time for not being obedient. We ain't got time for it.
That's right.
We don't have time for wandering around and going haphazardly through life. We ain't got time for it.
That's right.
We don't have time for trying to work this. Man, we got to get this thing right. We got to get this obedience thing to Christ and his commands. We got to get it right. We don't have time to play around. The Lord is returning for a church that is spotless, blemish-free, without wrinkle. How do I know we don't have time for this, man? I know what the rest of this passage says. For those of those that are found unfaithful, for those of those that don't get to return with him, those of those that he doesn't find elect, those of those that he doesn't find prepared and ready for his return. Verse 45. Who then is faithful and wise servant, whom his master has set over his household, and to give them their food at a proper time? Blessed is that servant whom the master will find so doing when he comes. Blessed is the servant. Blessed is the one that he finds doing his work. Blessed is the one that he finds being obedient. Blessed is the one that he finds faithful and true to him. Blessed is the one that he finds blameless and ready for him. Blessed is the one that is true to his word, that submits to him in all of their life. Blessed is the one. They follow his commands and they're ready for him. Verse 47. Truly I say to you, he will set him over all his possessions. But if that wicked servant says to himself, my master is delayed, and begins to beat his fellow servants and eats and drinks with drunkards, the master of that servant will come on a day when he does not expect him, and at an hour he does not know, and will cut him in pieces and put him with the hypocrites in the place that there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. The reality that we read in Revelation chapter 21 is that, yes, when Jesus comes, he will establish his dwelling place with us. And when he does so, the curse will be gone. There will be joy. There will be no more weeping. There will be no more pain. There will be no more thirst. There will be no more hunger. He will satisfy every need that we have. But the reality is that there is, in chapter 21, a burning fire of sulfur, the second death, the separation completely from him. There is a place full of weeping and gnashing. And at that point, the time is up.
Yeah.
He's come. He's returned. The time is up. Because my master delayed himself. The penalty of unfaithfulness to God is death. Is a permanent separation from all good things. Is a permanent separation from God. So I know that there's an urgency that I would be obedient to him, that I would be faithful to him. That I, it's like, Andrew, do you fear God? Yes, I fear God.
Yeah.
Proverbs 9:10 says that that fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. There is a righteous fear of the Lord. That I know God is God. That's something, that's why I'm really encouraged about us now doing DNA groups together. This is the revelation that me and two guys were having coffee together. I mentioned Radon the other week. Radon and Yuri, we would meet every week. And we sit together. There was one week we got together. We said, do you know what? I found out this week, God is God. What does that mean for him? Man, God has the final say. God's in control. And there is a fear in my heart, a healthy fear that says, yes, God is in control. He is God and King and Lord of all that. What he says goes.
That's right.
It is true.
That's right.
I love the fact that not only is he one that is true and righteous, but he also is full of grace and mercy. And that's why, man, together I can come before him and have this relationship of love, and he can follow. But what he says goes. I don't know if you were raised in a house that was that way, but I was raised in a house where what dad said, it went, right? I mean, and there is an eternal law that says what God says is true. It goes. It is. For us in this room, I pray that we would say, yes, God, you are God. Yes, Lord, I want to be obedient to you. Yes, God, I want to be faithful to you. Lord, find me about your business. Find me faithful to your word. Find me faithful to your word. God, I ain't got time to go be doing foolish things. We don't have time because we don't know the hour or the moment he returned. And when he returns, I pray that he finds me, I pray that he finds you faithful to his word, submitted to his lordship. Right? God is God, and we ain't got time for disobedience. We don't have time for doing our own thing. I love the Lord that in his correction and in his truth, he always invites us to himself. When I was preparing this word, my throat started burning. I couldn't even speak. I said, no, enemy, you ain't going to stop me from speaking the truth. He's coming back. Morning, what better response to this word than saying, God, search me. God, search me. He gets into I want to encourage you guys to read Matthew 24 and 25, because it goes, 25 starts going into the parables of the 10 virgins, those that were ready and those that weren't. They had to go start, they talk about the talents, those who were ready, those who weren't, and it goes into the final judgment, what it's going to be like for those who were ready and those who weren't. It's not just about saying, Lord, Lord, save me. I hope you get that. When we pray a prayer, when you pray a prayer to say, Lord, forgive me of my sins, it doesn't stop there. There's a life transformation that happens when we submit our lives to the Lord, to Jesus as Lord of our lives. But this morning, man, it's time to examine ourselves. It's time to examine ourselves. Say, God, make me blameless. God, forgive me. God, get this petty stuff out of whatever. Man, I was making a list. I said, man, pet sins, things that we think we can just keep on holding on to. Porn addiction, alcohol addiction, sleeping around, cutting corners, cheating and lying, anger and unforgiveness in our hearts. Man, we don't have time for this. The Lord's coming. The Lord's coming. So this morning I want to respond in repentance, respond and come into the Lord. Say, Lord, man, if there's anything in your life this morning that you're like, yeah, I need to get rid of that. I recognize that isn't like God. That isn't blameless. That isn't blemish free. That isn't holy. Man, if the Holy Spirit is convicting you on any of these points this morning, man, it's time to get right. It's like, Lord, forgive me. And Father, give us the boldness to be obedient to you. As we wait for you coming, Father, Lord, let us not get distracted by the things of life. Let us not get distracted by these things. Let us not go our own way, Father, but let us stay faithful to you. Because he's coming. He's coming. Let's pray this morning and respond to the Lord.